Okay, it's 1 o'clock, so let's go ahead and get started with our next speaker. This is Paolo Sandri. If you want to take it away?
Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Paolo Sandri, and I'm a marketing director with ST Microelectronics, and I'm going to show you a novel scalable energy proportional architecture for the direct conversion from the 48 volt to the point of load, where the point of load is can be a CPU, can be a GPU, can be a DDR, or a networking ASIC. So basically the high current, high demand chipsets. But before going into the details of the architecture, of course, you know, there are the, it's kind of a recurrent message. So what are the data center power challenges? And we have heard many times the same messages. I will repeat the message, and the data center energy consumption is a big deal. The, according to the US Department of Energy, in 2014, the US data center consumed about 70 billion kilowatt hour, and it is going to increase with a 4% growth rate between now and 2020, so the trend is going to increase. And also an interesting note that the report shows is that the efficiency improvement did play an important role in taming the growth rate of the data center industry energy consumption. So it is, as a comparison, if the efficiency level had stayed at the 2010 levels, the data centers in US would have used more than 40 billion kilowatt hour compared to you know, what they did in 2014. So the efficiency is an important aspect in the global data center power challenges. The second important challenge is the high power that is required by the you know, the CPU. The power level is increasing. Now we are at 165 watt. We are kind of foreseeing 240 watt, and also the GPU and the networking ASIC, we are talking about 350 watt of consumption today. So, and the DDR, of course, as well will increase. So the message is that, as I said, the power consumption for the data center is going to increase. So we need to do a more efficient data center and more efficient power architecture in order to you know, to kind of keep this trend under control. An overview of the possible power distribution, and they are not all, but it's just to summarize. So there is the 12 volt intermediate bus architecture power distribution. It is the most used today. And there is an AC to DC power supply unit, and there is a battery backup system with battery backup with a boost to provide energy to the DC line during the AC outage. Then there is the 12 volt bus bar with the multi-phase buck regulator that is, you know, has been around for many years and has been very much optimized in terms of performances. The other possibility is to have the 48 volt bus architecture. And in this case, let's say that the front end is the same. There is an AC to DC power conversion. Now the voltage is, instead of 12, is 48. And the battery backup system is much simpler. So in this case, you can connect virtually directly the battery to the 48 volt line. So you can save the boost, which is a power boost. So it's a saving in the cost of the system. And then you can have the local distributed conversion from the 48 to 12, and to 12 from 12 to the point of load. Of course, the goal is the 48 volt bus distribution is better because we already heard that we have 1/16 of the power distribution losses. We have a better efficiency of the AC because it's now 48 instead of 12. So there is a benefit in terms of efficiency, and you save the power boost, so you can put more server in the same space, so you increase basically the server efficiency. But I think that the challenge was is to make a direct conversion from the 48 volt down to the CPU. So we can keep the same lean battery backup system solution and at the same time do a one-step conversion from the 48 volt to the point of load. Okay. So to do this direct conversion, there are different challenges. So first of all, it's a direct conversion that is different from the usual, let's say, 48 volt conversion that we see, because we need not only to go to the sub volt or 1.2, but we need also to be compliant to the different digital ASIC, or in this case, for example, the Intel VR13 compliance CPU. So you need the system needs to be faster to respond. It needs to be able to follow the transient voltage VAD on the fly. So it's a more complicated architecture, not only because of the lower voltage that it needs to regulate, but also because there are some specific and very demanding power requirements. The other challenge that we wanted to address was to have a fully isolated architecture, because we think that having the option to use an isolated, fully isolated architecture and or a non-isolated architecture is a benefit, because you can use the fully isolated architecture also using the minus 48 volt from the telecom. So it's a broader range of application of the architecture. Then it has to be scalable, because scalability is important with this kind of load that there are different ranges of power. The scalability is an important aspect that we wanted to implement. And it has to have, of course, high efficiency, but not only high, but also flat efficiency. So maximize the efficiency across the possibly the entire load range. And to do this, we need to have phase shedding, pulse skipping, the usual features that have been so far optimized and developed for the 12-volt multiphase regulator. And we want also, last but not least, to be 400 volt input ready. So that's why we also insisted on the isolation, because when you move to 400 input volt, you need to have the isolation mandatory. So of course, as a company, STMicroelectronics, we have many years of experience in the multi-phase design, the 12 volt design. We have experience in the CPU VR with the digital core, several generations. We have IPs on scalability. We have, of course, the PM bus, AVS 1.3, the high voltage direct conversion know-how. So we put together all the ingredients that we had available, and with different new product ideas, product concept, and iteration, we managed to address all the challenges that this direct conversion was posing. So at the end of the day, we came out with a new architecture that I'm going to show you that is fulfilling all the challenges that we had. So this is the new architecture that we developed, and you see that it is an architecture that is of course fully isolated or isolated with a transformer. So there is a primary side, and there is a secondary side, and it's a resonant architecture with the current doubler, and this allows to be able to provide all the requirements that the Intel CPU, the GPU are demanding. So let's go a little bit into the details of the architecture. So you see that on the primary side, we have a resonant inductor, and we have two half bridge structures that are driven by a dedicated driver. We call it STRG04. And then on the secondary side, we have the resonant capacitor that works together with the resonant inductor on the primary side. Then we have the synchronous rectification with the output inductors that goes to the output capacitor. And these two synchronous rectificators are driven by a dedicated driver, STRG02. Everything is controlled by the digital controller on the secondary side. And the digital controller is basically the brain of the system that takes care of controlling the, of course, the loop and all the features that are required for the compliance with the digital ASICs. The digital isolator is used to transfer the commands from the digital controller to the primary side. Of course, this architecture, we wanted to have this architecture as flexible as possible. So what do we can have, we can also make this non-resonant if we remove the resonant inductor and the resonant capacitor. So it is natively resonant, but it can be non-resonant. And it can be also non-isolated if we remove the digital isolator. So there is the complete flexibility to implement the solution that is the best for the specific conversion, 48-volt conversion case. So the three key ingredients are, besides the passive components, the controller, the digital controller, the synchronous driver, the secondary side, and the primary side driver. Okay, so scalability is something that we wanted to have in this architecture, and the idea is to have digital control, one digital control that can drive up to six cells, and the cells is the structure that I described before with the primary side driver and the secondary side driver and the magnetics. So depending on the load demand, the design can be done with a different number of cells, and what it is important is that every cell is automatically interleaved, so there is a current sharing, and there is an automatic cell turn on and off during the load transient. So this is, for example, if you have a design that is starting with a certain power, and then during the implementation of the design you realize that maybe the power that you need is more, you can add one cell or remove one cell easily, because it's a modular approach, it's a scalable approach. So and this is also very useful for the onboard solution, but also on the modular approach when we talk about modules. So one cell can be stepped and duplicated, and it can go up to six cells. So scalability is definitely one important feature of this architecture that we wanted to implement. There are other architecture key advantages, of course, the first one is the capability to do a fully isolated resonant or non-resonant direct conversion. And if you can see on the graph on the right-hand side on the top, you can see that the current in the primary and the secondary side of the transformer is oscillating, is a resonant current, but the output current, the current in the output inductors is like, it's a linear current. So we have this kind of combination of a resonant architecture with the current doubler. And at the secondary side, another important observation is that the voltage at the secondary side is a semi-sinusoidal wave. So this automatically brings a very good noise positioning. So it generates very low noise, because we don't have an hard switch on the secondary side, but we have a more smooth voltage evolution. The efficiency maximization across the full load is the second important point of this architecture, as we were also commenting this morning. What it is important is, having a nice high efficiency, but if there is only one single cell, the approach is, at the end of the day, it's a curve. So it's more difficult. You cannot optimize the efficiency across the whole, the complete load range. So the fact that this architecture is kind of energy proportional by design, it helps to really keep the maximize the efficiency across all the load level. And this is possible to do because we have a zero voltage switching and zero current switching on both the primary and the secondary side. And we have, of course, the dynamic cell management or shedding, with also path skipping when there is only one cell working and the load is becoming lighter and lighter. So it can even go to path skipping by design. So doesn't require the heat sink. And of course, if you increase the efficiency, you're saving in OPEX. And we already talked about the scalability and the flexibility. This is an important feature, particularly with the range of application that this can cover, because this can be used for any virtually any digital load, and it's relatively easy to design, because it's it works like, at the end of the day, if you see it as a black box, you see the 48 volt input, and the output that you see is like a mimicking a multi-phase kind of behavior. So it's also easy to design, and we have all the tools that are necessary for a dedicated design. The an important factor that is important to highlight is that the architecture is able to source current, but also to sync current. So it's a sync and source mode, because with, as I said before, with the CPU, GPU, this kind of very demanding digital loads, there are VID on the fly, so the direct conversion architecture has to be able to sync and source current at the same time. So it's an important aspect. And this, the other point is they minimize noise content because of the sinusoidal, semi-sinusoidal waveform. So it is possible to put this portion of the circuit very close to the load without interfering, without generating noise, without having EMI problems, conducted or radiated, or much less at least. Of course, high power density and the telemetry with the PM bus compatibility and AVS 1.3 are other features that we have. So, okay. In terms, a couple of comments on the fully isolation strategy. So we decided to have this architecture natively supporting the full the fully isolation application, and the controller is, if you remember, is on the secondary side, and this because it is in direct connection with the digital ASIC, so it can communicate at the same level on the same side of the circuit with the digital load. And also, it can manage better and directly the remote sensing function. So you don't need to go through, you know, any move from the secondary side to the primary side. And of course, to drive the primary side driver, the digital isolator is required if a fully isolated architecture is implemented. And as I said before, the up to 60 volt, you don't need the fully isolation. But since this topology is also ready to go higher in voltage, we wanted to have a fully isolated option. So the fully isolation is an option; it's available to use, but it can be also non-isolated in case the design doesn't require necessarily the fully isolation. In terms of support tools, we call it eColumbus is the code name of the program, because it's composed by three devices, so the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria, just to give a little bit of color to the project. And so it's available, it's an online tool, and this is, of course, there is a schematic entry, so you put the schematic, you edit the components, the value, and then you put the specification that the cell or the architecture needs to do in terms of power conversion. And then you run the system, and you have the values for the control variables for the system. Because you can do a check on the bottom side of the screen, you can check the power capability for each cell. If you have a multi-cell architecture, you can see the efficiency, you can see the body plot, so the stability. And there is also a section that gives you the breakdown of the power losses. So in case you are not happy with the efficiency at a certain current level, you can see who is the major contributor, and you can go back to the schematic, change maybe the value of the DCR of the resonant inductor, or the RDSON of the synchronous FET. So you can do the kind of the iteration in order to get the most optimized design. And then, of course, you have all the documentation and that is generated by this. And this is from the software standpoint. From the hardware standpoint, we have a complete set of development tools. So we can, we call the Power Master tool, and this is used to generate the config file, like in the 12-volt CPU multiphase controller. So we follow the same kind of philosophy to make the life of the power design as easy as possible. So we wanted to be also design friendly. So then with this, we generated the NVM file, the config file, and then we have the flasher tools and so on. So nothing different compared to the 12-volt multiphase conventional approach. So we try to simplify the, you know, the activities as much as possible. In terms of offering what we can offer in terms of reference design, this is a list. It's not, you know, of course, the pictures are not in scale, but it's a list of, just to give you an idea, what is available in terms of reference design. So we have the reference design for the Intel VR13, and this is the number of cells that we use in each design. This is the output current and the power. And 1.8 volt with the 4 cells. Then we have the DDR, or the memory reference design for the DDR3 and DDR4, and this is a 2-cell architecture. Then we have this is an application for an ASIC, networking ASIC. It goes down to 0.9 volt, and it can deliver up to 300 amps. And here we use the full blast of the number of cells, so we go up to 6 cells. And of course, we can design each cell with higher power, but it is always a compromise between, you know, what is the space that you have available on the board and how much power you want to put in each cell based on the scalability that you want to have and the efficiency targets. And then we have the, we call this more point of load, because they are more, you know, on the PoL kind of conventional side, this one at least, so 54 to 12 volt with one single cell up to 500 watts. And then we have 54 to 1 volt, 80 watt, one cell, and 54 volt to 3.3, one cell. And this is, of course, the same scalable topology that we use to cover virtually any digital load that that you can have in a data center on board. So networking, storage, server, and GPU, artificial intelligence, etc. So the kind of idea of having an architecture that can be flexible, scalable, and used across all the rails. That was the one of the main ideas that we had at the beginning. And this architecture is also ideal for power module application because of its scalability by nature. So, in summary, we have developed this innovative resonant current doubler architecture that can fulfill the direct conversion from the 48 volt down to any digital load, and it can address some of the data center challenges in terms of making an ecosystem that is more efficient and, you know, also, you know, in the near future. It is fully isolated. It can be non-isolated, but it is natively fully isolated. It is scalable. It maximizes and flattens the efficiency thanks to the zero voltage switching, zero current switching. It is energy proportional, so it's a very performing solution for the digital load. And it is fully compliant to Intel, of course, requirements, VR13 specifically, with no waiver. So we are completely covering the Intel test plan. And it enables also the direct conversion from the 400 volt. So down the road, maybe, you know, there will be applications where the data center will change from 400 directed to the point of load. And last but not least, this product line is available in mass production since last year. So it's an available solution. So it's ready to use. So hopefully, with this short presentation, I've been able to give you a snapshot of what you can get from this, and you know, the performances and the available reference design. And we think that this architecture can really contribute to improve the data center power delivery and power efficiency. Okay. Thanks a lot for your attention and enjoy the rest of the OCP show. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.